What in the whole actual hell?
Why the hell am I in a shed? It's a fair question. It's a good question, and I'm very glad you asked. Currently, I'm in New York at my mother's house, where I grew up, where I started my woodworking journey, where I had my first shop in my woodworking career. And I thought it might be helpful to have a conversation about what's necessary at the beginning for those of you who are just getting into it, or even for those of you who have been doing it for a little while, to see kind of the progression that goes from the very beginning when you have nothing and you're starting from zero, and how that progresses over a span of whatever it's been, 15 years or so, of collecting machines, collecting tools, collecting experience. And so I'm in this shed because I know that a lot of you, especially at the very beginning, are limited in space, in resources, etc. And so all you might have is the corner of a shed somewhere. So how do you actually start making things under those conditions? I'm going to give you a few practical tips that you can apply to your situation. Tip number one, contractor grade equipment is good enough.
Oh my goodness. Oh,
this is like, I feel like a high school senior photo right now. There's no good way to sit. You're just gonna have to live with it. Any Hoosiers, here's the deal. We all think bigger is better. And with some reason, every cabinet shop you've ever seen, every professional furniture maker shop that you see has a cabinet saw because it has more power, because it allows you to break down larger objects like sheet goods or slabs more efficiently and frankly safer than with a contractor saw. However, they're expensive. They take up a lot of space. They're not always the right fit for what you're doing. Just because somebody who's doing something different from you, maybe has more experience than you, maybe is making larger objects than you, uses one, doesn't mean that you need one. Now, I've mentioned before, some of you may know that I grew up in the trades. I was a carpenter all coming up through high school and into college. So I've had contractor grade equipment around me all my life. This I've had since I was probably a teenager. Same with that. These two things are probably 20 something years old. And they're really decent pieces of equipment. If you can integrate some hand tools to do some finessing, if you can figure out clever ways to work around your limitations, these machines will give you what you need. They are a fraction of the cost of their larger, more precise counterparts. And again, if you're just starting out, you don't need to drop multiple thousands of dollars on a piece of equipment that you don't know how to really get the most out of just yet. What you need is a sharp, spinny thing that can cut through wood faster than a handsaw. That's all you need. And if you don't believe me that you can make high-end furniture on this, I just did it during the pandemic. I made multiple pieces of furniture using this table saw, doing the majority of my joinery on this table saw, and pieces that I think, if I'm honest, are quite good and hold up with all the rest of the furniture that I've made in my shop. And if you've got contractor-grade equipment lying around already, be clever about how you use it. Is it convenient to resaw with a sawzall? Absolutely not. It is maybe the most inconvenient way to do it, but can it be done? Yeah. Point is, I'm not saying go out and buy a sawzall for your fine woodworking projects. What I am saying is if you have tools lying around that are free that you can utilize and implement in the beginning of your journey as a woodworker, or if you're stuck in the middle of a global pandemic and need to make furniture anyway with what you have lying around, just figure it out. It's fine. As long as the end result is good, that's all that matters. Tip number two. You don't need all the things all at once. Now, look, is it nice to have an array of tools to choose from that make the operations maybe more efficient, maybe more accurate? Absolutely. That is a thing to strive for in the future. But when you're starting out, you don't need all of the things all of the time all at once. You can make do with a minimal set of equipment in order to maximize your budget. So how do I make objects with the things that I have on hand? Or what is the minimal set of equipment that I need in order to achieve the ability to make furniture?
I might make an argument that really all you need is a table saw. I think that would be a reasonable thing to do. It would limit you. You would be limited to, say, 3/4 inch pre-milled lumber from your big box stores, or paying a fee to have a lumber yard mill those things for you. So while it is limiting, it is possible to make furniture with only a table saw. Now you can then step up the game a little bit later and get yourself a planer, which is going to allow you to do things like make wood, take wood to different thicknesses to achieve different visual effects, or buy wood in the rough so that you can mill it yourself and save some money. And you don't need a big 24 inch helical head standalone machine. You can get a lunchbox planer like this. This thing does the job really quite nicely. While loud and heavy to pick up and put on a benchtop every time, it works, and it's a few $100 and you can get them secondhand for between $100 and $200. Like, they're really inexpensive for a piece of equipment that works pretty well. But once you've got these two pieces of equipment, the third one that I would say is really a basic necessity of the wood shop is the router. Again, a big fancy router with a plunge base that's 3¼ horsepower. Like, that's wonderful. That's good and well. But is it necessary? No. This one, I think, is 1.5 horsepower. Like, it's not much. Let's find out. 1.25 horsepower, 1¼ horse. This Rockwell router is at least 40 years old, but it works. You don't need a big fancy one. Piece of equipment number 3, probably a router. And then I think the next two, while they're not primary concerns, in my opinion, I know y'all are gonna disagree with me on one. The next two that I think are really important upgrades to make are a sander, a random orbit sander, and dust collection. Now, I can hear you in the comments already. Dust collection should be a primary concern. And you're not wrong. Safety is important. However, we're talking about getting into woodworking on a shoestring budget. Dust collection is very important. But if you buy a dust collector and you don't have a saw to use it on, is it like you're not? You just have a vacuum. You just have a vacuum. Can you work outside? Can you put a mask on? Like, there are alternatives that are cheaper than buying a piece of equipment. So yes, dust collection is of the utmost importance. I'm not saying skip on it. What I'm saying is, if you don't have the money to buy that, or if you buy that and that means that you don't have the money to buy lumber, what's the point of having it? Take your saw outside, use it out, like take it on a back porch, take it on a deck, wear a mask. There's other ways to get around it. But once you do have the finances to get that, because I don't know if y'all know this, your lungs are kind of a vital part of your body. Now the sander, you can get away without having a sander for a while, especially when what you are doing is learning technique and practicing mortise and tenons and rabbets and grooves and et cetera, et cetera. But eventually it gets to a point where you need to buy a sander, and that point comes pretty soon in the process. So random orbit sander, I would put it in that kind of 1B level of very important thing to buy. So if you're trying to get into this game, I don't think there's anything you can't build with these 5 pieces of equipment. Tip number 3, start small and grow. Yeah, we had to move inside. There was a thunderstorm that rolled through, but that's actually all right, because my third tip, start small and grow, is really about the projects you choose to take on early on in your woodworking journey. We all want to make the dining table that everybody sits at, the big statement piece that people walk into your home and they go,
oh my God, that's so beautiful. You're so talented.
Yeah, that's great. That's well, that comes with time, but early on, you may not have the space to make a thing the size of a dining table. It doesn't have to be a dining table, whatever the thing is, a big cabinet, a whole kitchen, whatever the thing that your mind is like, this is what makes me a woodworker. You don't need to do that right away. And there's a few reasons for it. Firstly, handling large timbers is a skill in and of itself. It takes a lot of know-how, it takes a lot of understanding of the material to figure out how to wield these big lumbers through machines, get accurate results, glue them up, mill them down, to deal with wood movement, to deal with all the plethora of things that come along with scaling up the size of the material and the problems that come along with that. So learning how to work accurately on small parts then progresses to learning how to work accurately on larger parts. That's just my opinion. That's the approach that I took because I was limited in my space and my budget, which brings me to the other reason to start small. Wood costs money. again, coming back to this budget argument, it can be difficult to justify the expense of a large piece. And even if you do, even if you take $500, $1,000, whatever it is, to go buy the materials to make the object, I've seen it happen many a time where then the person freezes and they're like, oh, now I'm financially invested in this to a degree that's giving me anxiety, and I'm afraid to progress forward because I'm afraid to make a mistake. That's a real concern. And so if you start small, the anxiety about making mistakes, not that it's gone, but it's assuaged to some degree. The cost of materials for a small candle box are factors of magnitude smaller than the cost of material for a large piece like a dining table. So you can learn and you can take risks and you can make mistakes on a smaller object that would be devastating to make early on a larger project. Let's take this box for example. Now, this is not my design. This is a Paul Sellers jam. This is early on in my career when I was just learning the technique of dovetailing and dovetailing by hand. But I decided, because it was probably the third or fourth box I had made, that I was gonna try a thing. And I had some oak and I had some cherry, and I decided to combine the two. But like, what, this is booty cheeks, y'all. Like this, what is this combination? Cherry and oak? There's a reason you don't see this combination, because it doesn't look good together. And looking at this right now, I've got white oak on the top and red oak on the back. I have no idea what I was doing. But okay, so now your argument is, Eric, great, small things are cool, but like, there's only so much you can do with small things as far as advancing your technical skill, right? Right? Setting design aside for a moment, because this was very early on in my career, and I've mentioned this piece already as to how it's just not very good from a design aesthetic standpoint. However, from a technical standpoint and the amount of techniques that are employed in this piece, it's reasonably complex in its attempt to do something interesting. This is a jewelry box I made for my mother some years ago. On the top here, got all of this stringing going on. Again, technically speaking, it's pretty good. Aesthetically, it's booty cheeks again. And then you have this rim around the miter where you have this bevel. There's a lot going on here, not to mention the dovetails on the front where I really pushed myself to make these tiny little pins. There's a lot happening here, technically speaking, that is compressed into a reasonably small object. So you can continue to advance these technical skills without growing the scale of the object. But listen, I've got other examples still. Let's turn this camera around. Here's another excellent example of what you can do in a small space. I made this in the garage during the pandemic, I believe. It's just a pair of bookshelves. But even though they're small, there's still a tremendous amount of technique in here. Number one, the joinery used for these corners is essentially a shouldered dado, like a mini mortise and tenon that has some floating tenons in it. Then on the back pieces, those are shop sawn cherry veneers. So not only do you have resaw techniques, but you have dressing veneers, you have actually veneering, and you have a copper piece down here and a brass piece up here. So you have these inlay techniques that are being used. And then all of these edges have been curved and shaped by hand. So you have hand shaping techniques as well. And then from a design perspective, the reason that the copper piece and the brass piece are the way they are is because the sun rises on that side of the house and sets on that side of the house. It's a nod to where the space is in physical space and how it interacts with the world around it. So there's a lot going on in what, a 36 inch by 24 inch section of a half wall that's otherwise dead space. There's a lot you can play with in there. So friends, that's that for this week. I hope this was helpful. I know it was different, but I hope that it gives you a sense of kind of where I started as a woodworker. Those space limitations, the budgetary limitations, maybe that's really reminiscent of kind of where you are. And if it's not where you are, that's fine too. I'm not saying that you have to do these things. I'm just saying that this is the way that I approached it, and it might be helpful to see. This is kind of tips that I would give to young Eric. Let's put it that way. So if you want to see other videos like this, like maybe a critique of my early work, some of the pieces that are at my mother's house, I think that might be an interesting video. Drop a comment down below. Let me know. I'm happy to kind of expand outside of my own shop so that you can kind of see my world, as it were, and maybe you can glean some information and useful bits from it. Until next week, friends, get in the shop, go make a thing. Cheers.